Live from Las Vegas, it's theCUBE. Covering InterConnect 2017. Brought to you by IBM.
Okay, welcome back everyone. We are live in Las Vegas for IBM InterConnect 2017. This is IBM's cloud show and now data show. This is theCUBE's coverage. I'm John Furrier with my co-host Dave Vellante. Our next guest is Meg Swanson, VP of Marketing for Bluemix. The whole kit and caboodle, soft layer, Bluemix. Now you get the Watson data platform, IoT, the cloud's growing up. How you doing? Good to see you again.
It's good, good to see you guys. And so every time we get together, it's just huge growth. Every month to month. So yes, so under Bluemix, we pulled together infrastructure. Yep. So the area that was called SoftLayer. And because we had developers that absolutely you need a provision down to bare metal servers, all the way up to applications. So we pulled the infrastructure together with the developer services, together with our VMware partnership. So all in a single console, you know, continuing to work on with clients on just having a unified experience. So that's why we have it under the Bluemix.
You knew us when we were just getting theCUBE started. We knew you when you were kicking off the developer program with Bluemix. Announced here in theCUBE. Seems like 10 dog years ago, which is about 50 years. Now that was what, 4 years ago now? Are you 4 years in?
Yeah, because I remember running from the Hackathon Club. We had just ended like a virtual reality session, and I had to run, and then I sat down, and we started immediately talking about Bluemix, and we just launched it.
So give us the update. You guys have been making a lot of progress, and we've been watching. You've been fantastic, because you really had to run fast and get this stuff built out, because cloud native wasn't called cloud native back then, it was just called cloud, but essentially it was the cloud native vision. Services, microservices, APIs, things we've talked about that. What's the progress? Give us the update and the status, and where are you?
Yeah, so I mean, obviously just massive growth in services and our partners. So when you look at, we had Twitter up with us today, we've had continual growth in the technology partners that we bring to bear, and then also definitely cloud native, but then also helping clients that have existing workloads on how to migrate. So massive partnerships with VMware. We also just announced partnership with Intel HITRUST on secure cloud optimization. So we just, absolutely, when we first met, we talked so much about you're going to win this with an ecosystem. And I mean, the coolest thing is seeing that pay off every day with the number of partners that we've been so blessed to have, you know, coming to us and working together with us to build out all these, this ecosystem for our clients, so.
And what's the differentiator? Because what's happening now is you're starting to see the clear line of sight from the big cloud players. You have you guys, you have Oracle, you see Microsoft, you see SAP, you all got the version of the cloud. And it's not a winner-take-all market, it's a multi-cloud world, as we're seeing. Certainly open source is driving that. How do you guys differentiate? And what's the, is it the same message? What's new is, in terms of IBM's differentiators? What's the key message?
Now we're absolutely staying core to the reason we went into this business, right? And so we are looking at what are the challenges that our clients are looking to solve, how do we build out the right solutions for them, and look at the technologies they're using today and not have them just forklift everything, you know, to a public cloud, but walk with them every step of the way. So it's absolutely been about, you know, uncovering the partnerships between on-premises and cloud, how you make that seamless, how you make those migrations in minutes versus, you know, hours and days. So it's really the growth that we've seen is around helping clients get to that journey faster, or if they're not meant to go fully public cloud, that's okay too. So we've been absolutely expanding our data centers, making sure we have everything lined up from a compliance standpoint, because country to country, we have so many regulations that we need to make sure we're protecting our clients in.
You know, I want to ask you, I mean, David Kenny referenced it a little bit today, sort of talked about, you know, we built this for the enterprise. It wasn't, didn't stem out of a retailer or a search. I don't know who he was talking about, but Martin Schroeder on the IBM earnings call said something that I wanted to get your comment on, if we can unpack a little bit. He said, importantly, we've designed Watson on the IBM cloud to allow our clients to retain control of their data and their insights, rather than using client data to educate a central knowledge graph.
Correct.
That's a nuance, but it's a really big statement. And what's behind that, if I can infer, is use the data to inform the model, but we're not going to take your data IP and give it to your competitors.
Right.
Can you explain that a little bit and what the philosophy is there?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, that is a core tenet of what we do. So it's all about clients will bring their data to us to learn, to go to school, but then it goes home. So we don't keep client data. That's critical to us, that everything is completely within the client's infrastructure, within their data privacy and protection. We are simply applying our cognitive, artificial intelligence, machine learning to help them advance faster. It's not about taking their insights and learning and fueling them into our cloud to then, you know, resell to other teams. So that, absolutely, it's great that you bring up that very nuanced point, but that's really important in today's day and age. Your data is your lifeblood as a company, and you have to trust where it's going, you have to know where it's going, and you have to trust that those machine learnings aren't going to be, you know, helping other clients that are possibly on the same
cloud. Is it your contention that others don't make that promise, or you don't know, or you're just making that promise?
We're making that promise. So it's our contention that the data is the client's data. And when you look at the partnerships that we've made throughout, you know, cloud, throughout Watson, it's really companies that have come to us to solve problems. So you look at the healthcare industry, you look at all these partnerships that we have, everything that we've built out on IBM Cloud and within Watson has been to help advance client cases. So you rarely see us launching something that's, you know, completely unique to IBM that hasn't been built together with a client, with a partner, versus, you know, there are other companies out there in this market where they're constantly providing infrastructure to run their own business, maybe their own retail store and their own search engine, and they will continue to do that, and they absolutely should. But at the end of the day, when you're a client, what do you want to do? Are you trying to build somebody else's business, or do you want someone who's going to be all in on your business and helping you advance, you know, everything that you need to do?
Well, it seems like the market has glommed onto public data plus automation.
Yeah.
But you're trying to solve a harder problem. Explain that.
Yeah, well, when you look at the clients that we're working with and the data that we're working with, it's not just, you know, information that's out there to, you know, work in a sandbox environment and, you know, it's available to anyone, like, you know, baseball statistics or something that's just out there in the wild. Every client engagement we're in, I mean, this is their critical data. So you look at financial services, we just launched, you know, the great financial services solutions for developers. You look at those areas and, oh my word, you cannot share that data. Yet, those clients, you look at the work we're doing with H&R Block, I mean, you have to look at, that is absolutely proprietary data, but how do we send in cognitive to help us learn, to help teach it, help teach them alongside, for the H&R Block example, the tax advisor, so we're helping them make their business better. It's not as if we ingested all of the tax data to then run a, you know, tax solution service from IBM. So it's just, it's a nuance, but it's an important nuance of how we run this company.
So 7 years ago I met this guy, and he said, 2010, John, you said, data is the new development kit. And I was like, what are you talking about? But now we see this persona of data scientist and data engineer and the developer persona evolving. How are you redefining the developer?
Yeah, it's a great point, because we see cognitive, artificial intelligence, machine learning development and developers really emerging strong as a career path. We see data scientists, especially where, as you're building out any application, any solution, data is at the core. So you had it 10 years ago, right?
You wrote the blog post in 2008, but I did mention that Dave when I first met him in 2010. No, but this is the premise, right? Back then, because the web infrastructure, web scale guys were doing their own stuff. So the data needs to be programmable.
Yeah.
So we've been riffing on this concept, and I want to get your thoughts on this. What DevOps was for infrastructure as code, we see a vision in our research at Wikibon that data as code, meaning developers just want to program and get data. They don't want to deal with all the under the hood production complicated stuff like data sets, the databases, and maybe the wrangling could be done by another process. So there's all this production heavy lifting that goes on, and then there's the creativity and coolness of building apps.
Yeah.
So now you have those worlds starting to stabilize a bit. Your thoughts and commentary on that vision.
Yeah, I mean, that's absolutely where it has been heading and is continuing to head. And as you look at just all the platforms that developers get to work in right now, so you have, you know, augmented reality, virtual reality are not just being segmented off into a gaming environment, but it's absolutely mainstream. So you see where developers absolutely are looking for, you know, what is a low-code environment for? I'd say more the productivity. So how do I make this app more productive? But when it comes to innovation, that's where you see, that's where the data scientist is emerging more and more every day as a you know, role. You see those cognitive developers emerging more and more because that's where you want to spend all your time. So my developers have spent, you know, the weekend, came back on Monday and said, well, what'd you do? Oh, I, you know, wrote this whole, you know, getting started guide for this Watson Cognitive Service. I'm like, that's not your job. Yeah, but it's fun. So, I mean, that's
yeah, they're geeking out on the weekends, having some beer and doing some hackathons.
It's so exciting to see. So that's where that innovation side, you know, that's where we're seeing absolutely the growth. And one of the partnerships that we announced earlier today is around our investment in just that training and learning. So with Galvanize.
What was the number? How much?
$10 million. Yep.
So evangelizing and getting soft on the ground up, getting people trained on cognitive AI.
Yeah. So it's really about making an impactful investment in the work that we started actually a couple years ago when we were talking. We started building out these garages.
Yeah.
So the concept was we have startup companies. We started partnering with Galvanize, who has an incredible footprint across the globe. And when you look at what they were building, we started embedding our developers in those offices, calling them garages, and because that is your workshop. That's where you bring in companies that want to start building applications quickly. And you saw a number of the clients we had on stage today consistently started in the garage, started in the garage, started in the garage.
Yeah, we had one on theCUBE earlier.
Yeah, exactly. So they start with us in the garage, and then we wanted to make sure we're continuing to fuel that environment because it's been so successful for our clients. So we're pouring into Galvanize and companies in training and making sure these areas that are really you know, in their pioneering stages, like artificial intelligence, cognitive,
all right, so on
learning.
That point, you bring up startups in the garage, a two-pronged question. So I'm putting together an enterprise readiness matrix.
Yep.
So you have startups who are building on the cloud who want to sell to the enterprise, and then you have enterprises themselves who are adopting hybrid cloud or combination of public-private. What does enterprise readiness mean to you guys? Because you guys have a lot of experience.
Yeah.
I mean, Google Next, they said, oh, we're enterprise, and they're really not, right? So they're not ready yet, but they're going that way. You guys are there.
Yeah.
What is enterprise readiness?
Yeah, and I see a lot of companies have ambitions to do that, which is what we need them to do. Because as you mentioned, it's a multi-cloud, you know, environment for clients, and so we need clouds to be enterprise ready. And that really comes down to security, compliance, scalability, you know, multiple zones. So it comes down to making sure you don't have just 5 developers that can work on something, but how do you scale that to 500? How do you scale that to 500,000? So you've got these, you know, companies that you have to be able to ensure that developers can immediately interact with each other. You need to make sure that you've got the right compliance by that country, the data leaving that country, and it's why you see such a focus from us on industry, because enterprise grade is one thing. Understanding an industry top to bottom when it comes to cloud compliance is a whole other level, and that's where we're at. So
it's really hard too. I mean, most people oversimplify cloud, but it's extremely difficult.
It is, because it's not just announcing a healthcare practice for cloud doesn't mean you just put everybody in lab coats and send out, you know, new digital material. It is, you have to make sure you've got partnerships with the right companies, you understand all the compliance regulations, and you know, you've built everything and designed it for them, and then you've brought in all the partner services that they need, and you've built that you know, in a private and a public cloud environment. And that's what we've done on healthcare, that's what we're doing on finance, you see all the work we're doing with blockchain, and we are just going industry by industry and making sure that when a company comes to us in an industry like retail, or you saw American Airlines on stage with us today. We're so proud to be working with them and looking at everything that they need to cover from, you know, regulation, uptime, maintenance, and ensuring that we know and understand that industry and can, you know, help guide and work alongside of them.
Well, in healthcare and financial services, I mean, the number of permutations are mind-boggling.
Yeah.
So what are you doing? You're pointing sort of Watson to help solve those problems, and that's, you're codifying that and automating that and running that on the cloud? Is that?
that's a part of it. So part of it is absolutely learning. So the whole, you know, data comes to school with us to learn, and then and it goes back home. So that's absolutely part of it is the cognitive learning. The other part of it is ensuring you understand the infrastructure. So what are the on-premises servers that industry has? You know, how many transactions per second, per nanosecond are happening? What's the uptime around that? How do you make sure that, you know, what points you're exposing? What's the security baked into all of that? So it's absolutely, cognitive is a massive part of it, but it is walking all the way through, you know, every part of their IT environment.
Well, Meg, thanks for spending the time coming on theCUBE and giving us the update. We'll certainly see you out in the field as we cover more and more developer events. We're going to be doing most, if not all, of the Linux Foundation stuff.
Yep.
Working a lot with Intel and a bunch of other folks that you're partnering with, so we'll see you guys out at all the events, DockerCon, you name them, they're all there. So
we'll be there too.
Microservices,
right,
we even get to Kubernetes. We're going to have another session on containers and microservices. Meg Swanson here inside theCUBE, Vice President of Bluemix Marketing. It's theCUBE with more coverage after this short break. Stay with us. More coverage from Las Vegas.